Think of it this way. Your wheels and tyres provide the only connection between your car and that great car parking in the sky. You fit the right wheels and tyres and ask them to do the wrong job, and that will happen. That could happen to you if your tyres are badly worn or if you're trying to corner a bit faster than James Hunt. And we've made that happen by fitting that dealer Opel team car with the wrong tyres. It's fitted with slicks, dry weather tyres, plenty of rubber for grip, but no tread pattern to move the water away. Put it on a wet road, that's what happens. Not the sort of thing you want to happen in the middle of a rally either. A point that I put to the driver of that car, ace Yorkshire rally driver, Tony Ford. Tony Ford, presumably that's exactly the sort of thing you'd like to avoid in the middle of a rally.
Yes, that's right. Hopefully we wouldn't get the two combinations together. We would be very careful to avoid running with these tyres when the conditions were either wet or slippery.
When would you use these tyres?
When we were pretty sure that the roads were going to remain dry, no water about, no standing water, and no mud or gravel on the surface.
But what's special about them that makes them so good in the dry and so poor in the wet?
Well, the main reason why they grip the road better in the dry is because you've got more rubber in contact. When you've got treads in the tyre, it means that there is no actual rubber touching the road. The tread pattern normally is for just draining the water away from the tyre surface to allow the actual rubber to touch the road.
So with a very flat tyre like this, you get an aquaplane.
That's right, yes. You get a build-up of water between the tread and the road surface. And with the increase in speed, the pressure builds up and eventually lifts the tyre off the road itself. Mm. So you then lose control of the car.
And, of course, presumably in a rally, you would be running on alloy or magnesium wheels.
Well, basically, yes, because it cuts down unsprung weight and it helps brake cooling and all this sort of thing.
Tony Ford, thanks very much indeed.
Now, during and after the First World War, this is the sort of tyre and rim which evolved. A tall wheel by today's standards. A narrow section across the tyre, there, and a tendency to part company from the rim, hence very high pressures were needed to keep the tyre on the rim, anything up to 65 pounds a square inch. This beaded edge there actually slipped in to the jaws there on either side of the rim. Well, up until the early 50s, most car tyres used in Europe were of cross-ply construction, like that one, with the plies laid at an angle of about 40 degrees to the line of the bead there. And then came the radial tyre, with the plies running almost straight across from bead to bead. The radial brought with it the advantages of longer life, better road holding, better braking, performance, and, as well you know, higher cost. Another dramatic increase in modern tyres came when they stopped using the stuff that you tap from trees, real rubber, and started using synthetic rubber. After the early synthetics came the even better high-mu synthetics, and you can see the fantastic increase in grip available. The high-mu tyre in the wet has almost as much grip as the natural rubber tyre in the dry. Well, that's progress for you, and it's progress that leads to the development of specialist tyres, like this one. There you have it, a tyre and wheel from the late Donald Campbell's record-breaking Bluebird. A nasty moment for all concerned, and according to statistics, we have our nasty moments once every 18 months. The puncture measures an eighth of an inch across, and it's usually caused by a nail without its head, which enters the crown of the tyre. Statistics. Perhaps one of the most significant developments to reduce the dangers in those statistics came with the perfection of this, the de novo run-flat wheel and tyre. There are similar, though less developed, ideas from Pirelli, Rosafe and Avon. Let me explain. There is a necklace of reservoirs like this running round inside the tyre. Now, once the tyre is punctured, these reservoirs have the valve there at the top depressed, and they release a lubricant into the tyre. The lubricant reduces the friction between the internal surfaces of the tyre, and within seconds of the puncture, there's enough vapour given off to inflate the tyre to a pressure of 4 to 5 pounds a square inch. And that is enough run-flat capability for 100 miles at 50 miles an hour.
And there's no doubt about it that we do tend to take our tyres very much for granted. We fit them and then we forget them. And yet the motor car tyre is a highly specialised piece of equipment. No one knows that better than a man like Harry G, the competition's tyre man from Goodyear. Harry, here are a set of rally tyres. They're all different to look at. They're all for specialist jobs, yes?
Yes, correct.
And yet these three at the end really don't look that much different from the sort of tyres I could fit on my own car.
No, these actually, you could fit these on your own car, and they're designed for the up-and-coming rally driver for restricted events. The only difference is the speed rating and just the tread design, but they are made to do the same job for tarmac.
So this is for the clubman who wants to keep costs down?
Yes.
But now we get into the highly specialised area. What about a tyre like that, for instance? When would I use that?
That, again, is a specialised rally tyre for the clubman, up-and-coming, who doesn't want to spend so much money. It can be used in the forest, on stages, and also on tarmac.
So this is an all-weather tyre?
All-weather tyre for all conditions.
Right. What about that thing? This is very knobbly.
That tyre, actually, is designed for studding originally, but studs are fading out because of doing damage to the road. And it is designed now because of these suction cups here. On the RAC rally, on packed snow and ice, they act as suction and grip on the ice and attract good traction.
So this is an expensive, highly specialised tyre for snow and ice?
Yes.
Right. What about that one?
This tyre is in a different compound. It is our best rally special stage tyre. It's used by Tony Fall, and it is a soft compound for performance. And in the dry, it does 12 miles to a special stage on the rear of a car.
What, you mean it can wear out instead of that?
You actually wear a tyre out in 12 miles.
My goodness me, I'm glad I'm not painful. What about that? That looks really like a racing tyre.
This is further development. It is part race tyre. It is a race rally tyre, a special construction, modified Formula One compound for rallies, which are all tarmac, such as the Manx Rally, and for special stages, such as Epant on the Welsh and Otterburn on the Scottish.
Now, you mentioned the word compound there. Are all these tyres made from exactly the same kind of rubber, mixed in the same way?
Not all of them. The mixing's more or less the same way, but these two are of a different compound.
Right.
Full now, performance.
How would I decide, supposing I were a rally team manager, what makes me decide to use a particular type of tyre? The weather forecast?
The weather forecast. The manager checks on the weather forecast before the rally and during the rally, and the team usually carries a variety of tyres so that their service crew can put on these tyres at the start of a stage.
Mm. But is, say, assuming that that one there were the tyre that I decided to use for really quite a large size rally car, if I were then the manager of a team of small cars, would I use that type of tyre?
Yes, certainly. It is a good tyre for all types of rally car, for performance. If you're looking for performance, that is the type of tyre to use.
So, in other words, your choice of tyre, then, in competitive work, depends on what the weather's doing, not on particularly what kind of car you're driving.
That's true, yes.
I've got it.
Yes.
Let's move on now to racing tyres. Here's a Formula One tyre. Now, this is a slick, isn't it?
That's true, yes. This is what we use on Formula One, and the idea of a slick tyre is for dry conditions.
And yeah, well, we've seen how hopeless they are in the wet. That's
yes.
The one that Tony Fall lost in a big way. Are they good in the dry?
Very good in the dry. The compound is designed, which is pretty sticky if you feel it. And after a couple of laps, the temperature builds up to 230 Fahrenheit, and then the compound really comes in, and which gives you traction and speed.
So here, this is presumably made from a very soft rubber, is it?
Yes.
Mm. And doesn't last very long.
And doesn't last long. Usually practice and race for Formula One.
Right. What's that mini one down there? That's got to be the smallest racing tyre in the world, hasn't it?
That must be, yeah. That's the latest development on our Formula One project, and it is for the six-wheel Tyrrell.
Oh, I see.
And it's, as you can see, it's in slick form, which they use four on the front of the car.
Right. But if it's raining at Brands Hatch, one of those, yes?
Definitely, yeah. This tyre is in a softer compound still, which the compound gives traction in the wet. But also the design, as you can see, these sipes for water dispersion.
These are called sipes, aren't they? They're little grooves down the side.
Yes, that's true. You get water dispersion and the compound to give traction. The idea is to get rid of the water quickly so that you don't spin and have a big accident.
Right, well, that's very fair, isn't it?
Yes.
Look, you've obviously spent many years and a lot of money developing highly specialised tyres. What possible use is all this technology to me as an ordinary motorist?
Well, a lot of people don't realise, but all this information is fed back into the lab for road tyres. We use different constructions, different fabrics and different compounds. And all this is analysed and fed back into the lab for road use.
And it pays off in the end.
And it pays off in a big way.
Harry G, thank you very much indeed.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Well, there we are, the story behind highly specialised competition tyres and how they ultimately affect us, the motorist. And a final thought. Look at that. That is a contact patch. That's the amount of rubber your tyre puts on the road at any one time. So just four of those between you and that great car park in the Wansett.